everything is set from Star Trek Deep Space Nine and the inconceivable theme from Princess Bride. Please welcome to the Edmonton Expo stage, Wallace Shawn.
The type of theater I really resonated you more with you more deeply than some of the other characters that you have.
Trying to do a semi-okay because it's actually almost impossible to do a good job, certainly in a movie. You don't have much time to rehearse. You rehearse maybe a couple of times before you have to film. And you're so even if the day before you read the scene and the scene is Mr. Smith, that's your part. Mr. Smith comes in and he goes into the office and he says, "Hey everybody, how's it going?" You have that paper that Mr. Jones wanted me to sign, and that's your scene. And you read it, and you think, well, that will be an easy day. I can play that. But then you get there, and you know you're not really Mr. Smith. You woke up as, you know, Wally. And now they're asking you to be Mr. Smith and pretend to be in an office when actually you're on the set of a movie. And you're sort of thinking, wow, how would I say this if I were really Mr. Smith in a real office? How can I say it? And you begin to realize, oh, I don't remember. I'm not sure I know how I would say it. To make it really believable. Hello. No. Hello. Oh, that doesn't sound real. Hello. That doesn't sound sincere. It sounds like a guy trying to play a scene in a movie, not like in real life. So it's quite scary. And if you get five chances at it, takes, maybe by the fifth, you sort of think, oh, yeah, that's not too bad. Or maybe on the first take, you get lucky and you think, right, it seems like a person. But that's what I'm thinking about, you know. And I'm not thinking about 10 years later, a nice audience member watching it.
Are we talking about Toy Story now? Can we go there?
We can go there.
The film came out, and I remember it was on my birthday, so it was a big day for me. And at the time, Pixar was a relatively new thing. It's for them, this was like their first big feature. It was this new type of animation. Did you ever have any doubts going into it? Being like, I don't know, this is going to catch on, because we obviously know what happened after Toy Story, but did you ever dream it would even go that way?
Well, I mean, I was giving a reading of a play that I wrote, because I write these weird plays. I've been doing that for 40 years or something. I gave a reading in San Francisco, and it was a pretty grim play. I mean, it was quite a serious political play. It was a one-person play. Fever, and it's political, and it's sort of quite grisly and grim. And a few serious people came up after the play and talked with me. And this strange man appeared carrying a plastic dinosaur. And he said, that I'm meeting you. I've written a film time, and it was a company that had just made one small short about the land. And they sent me the land short. Yes, I mean, I did think, wow, this best land movie that it was very believable. But it was just another job. And I basically I am politically, let's say, from a U.S. point of view, very left wing. From a Canadian point of view, I'm not as weird, but in I'm an extremist. And so there are a lot of films, scripts that I find too nauseating, and I don't do them. Basically, if I don't find it nauseating, I'll do it.
That's a great rule of thumb.
That's crazy to think that that film and the success of Toy Story really shaped the history of animation from that point on. Pixar grew to become what it's supposed to become, and the animation today is drastically different, really because of that film. Now, following along those years and doing Toy Story, Toy Story 2, and recently with 3, what was it like to kind of get back together with that cast that you now maybe, you know, have quite a history with?
Well, sadly, in animation, you don't really interact with
even on, like, the press tours or anything like that, when you're putting that
out? We all came to L.A. to watch a little sketch, not to L.A., I can't remember either L.A. or San Francisco, but the whole cast gathered to watch Toy Story 3 in the form of just sketches, drawings, and still everybody was crying, even at these just sketches with the voices being done by just the people who worked at Pixar, not actors. But that's how I met everybody. But otherwise, basically, you're in a little glass booth with about 10 directors who sometimes are there, or sometimes they're just mysterious voices sort of coming out of a loudspeaker, and you're alone in a little spaceship, really. So you don't really get to make this interacting with the other actors. In animation, it's all in your own imagination.
More difficult for you then as an actor to not be able to like emote physically and you know show expression and really just do it all through your voice.
It is a special discipline. And of course the directors of animation know what the picture will be. You don't know as an actor. So you have to accept the fact that they tell you what to do in a way that would be unpredictable if it were a film. I mean, in a film, if someone said to you, well, could you, you know, your line is, well, here we are again. If you were on a movie set and somebody said, Wally, we prefer that you would say that line with your high register. Hello, everybody. Here we are again. Well, that would be almost a case for that director to be fired. It's just not done. And they considered it incredibly rude that you were intruding on the province of the actor. But in animation, that would be normal. They would say, if you say that twice as fast, and in a lower voice. And you just sort of say, aye, aye, sir, wow. Okay.
And I got to ask you before we throw to audience questions, how has it changed for you from going back to Toy Story and some of the early animation to recently? What was the biggest difference for you like on the industry perspective? The biggest difference voicing, you know, that first, you know, reps for the first time compared to lately. Obviously, maybe they had a little bit bigger budget, the food was a bit better, and craft services, but any big, other big differences with the more recent film?
I suppose, you know, I wouldn't say I'm senile, but I am older, so, I mean older than I was before, so when they would say, could you do it faster, could you do it a little faster, I would have more insecurity thinking, oh my God, did they always say that, or have I just really become so old that I'm not, that what sounds normal to me sounds horribly slow to them. So I've experienced a little more insecurity. Also, of course, knowing that I was involved in a multi-million dollar business when I'm making, rather silly things like, you know, your line is, oh no! If you're falling off a truck, the first time around, it was just fun. The second time, I suppose there's an awareness in the background, oh, this is a big business. So there's, the stakes are high. And of course, on any job, you don't want to get fired. They can't fire me because they've got me in the other movies. So there's I'm less likely to be fired from Toy Story than anything else. So I'm worried a little bit less about that. On a regular movie, I'm always thinking, ew, I might just be fired today.
Would Toy Story be the same without Wallace, guys?
No.
So we do have a couple mics set up here. If you guys have some questions for the lovely Wallace, please come on.
I thought supposed to be funny. And there was a kind of a battle that went on. And I ended up just doing it my way, because I think the writers kind of liked it. And so after that, there were no problems. I mean, except it's very, it's an interesting discipline to wear a gigantic head. You know, you can't touch your own face for, say, 15 hours. And, well, you will notice that we all sort of do. And so it's interesting not to be able to, but I also had very long fingernails. And the physical side of life was challenging during those days. And it's also a discipline to lie in a chair for 3 or 4 hours while people put makeup on you. And, you know, to not leap up to learn how to sort of space out and be happy in a pickup chair. And, of course, you can be burned if they take the thing off too quickly. And that did happen to me once, because it's the end of the day, and some people are in a hurry, and you can get a chemical burn. I mean, it was a thrilling experience to be on Deep Space Nine. It was amazing to be, I mean, as an actor, I felt totally free inside that makeup in a way that you rarely do.
Since you already talked about Toy Story, I was wondering if you could describe other voice work that you've done that I really enjoyed, like Incredibles, Family Guy, a Goofy movie, etc.
When I was a kid, I thought I wanted to be an animator and to work for Walt Disney. Then I grew up and I, you know, when I was 20, I was studying history and politics and thought maybe I would be a civil servant of some description. If you'd said, well, you know, you'd be working at the UN, or do you think you'd be working for Walt Disney? Studio in L.A., and I sort of got my check signed by the Walt Disney Company, and I realized all this is exactly what I expected when I was 9 years old. Quite amazing. I've always liked cartoons.
Yesterday,
lips. And when I had auditioned to be in the movie, I had said, obviously, you're not going to make us really, you know, go to the world's highest cliffs and, you know, do the scene there. And he said, oh, no, no, there will be stuntmen who do that. But then, when I actually got to England, where they were making the movie, they said, well, this, you know, you're going to be on these, a small forklift, 35 feet up at the top of this room. And I sort of began to feel faint, and I said, I really don't know if I can do that. I have a terrible fear of heights, and I just don't know if I can do it. And the director was very nice and tried to make it so that I didn't have to spend too much time up there. But I was tied to Andre the Giant, and he was very, very sweet to me and offered me cognac from his flask that he had. And I think he was a fabulous guy. He was someone who had grown up, obviously abnormal, and but very, very smart, and thinking, what can I do in life that will enable me to travel? Because he wanted to travel, and he thought, if I become a wrestler, if I succeed, I will be able to travel all over the world. And happen.
Same story. Thanks.
So I might not have been able to stick it out as an impoverished playwright for a lifetime. I don't know. The acting thing came along by chance, not by idea. And suddenly I was able to make a living at it. And so I never really had to make that choice.
We have got time for one more question, so we are going to be